वेलकम बैक। इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट पाइपलाइन शेड्यूलिंग। सो पाइपलाइन शेड्यूलिंग मीन्स हाउ वी कैन फीड इनपुट्स टू द डिफरेंट स्टेजेस ऑफ पाइपलाइन सो दैट द कॉन्फ्लिक्ट शुड नॉट अकर और दोज इनपुट्स शुड नॉट क्रिएट अ कोलिजन अमॉन्ग द सब्सिक्वेंट स्टेजेस। ओके, सो आई हैव ऑलरेडी टोल्ड यू about a classification, that is linear pipeline versus non-linear pipeline. In linear pipeline, this sort of problem related to collision or conflict will not occur. Okay, why? Because we have to provide new set of inputs in each of the clock cycle. That means when a first clock cycle ends, we have to provide the new inputs in the next clock cycle if required, if necessary. Okay, we cannot provide new set of inputs, more than one set of inputs in the same clock cycle. Okay, so for linear pipeline, we do not need pipeline scheduling. Okay, because all the stages are connected through a linear chain. Okay, when we feed inputs to the first stage, it will propagate to the next stage in the next clock cycle. There would be some computation, and then it would be propagated to the another stage in the another clock cycle. Okay, so for linear pipeline, we do not require pipeline scheduling. For a non-linear pipeline, where we have feed forward or feedback connections, we require pipeline scheduling. Okay, we require a schedule so that different inputs should not create a collision in any of the stages. So let's say this is a non-linear pipeline example. We have already seen this example in the previous lecture. So here it will create an issue. Okay, why? Because this is a feed forward connection, so S1 output is going to directly, it is giving output. S1 output is also directly connected to the input of S3, so this is your feed forward connection. Now output of S3 again coming back to S1, so this is your feedback connection. So for a non-linear pipeline where you have feed forward and feedback connections, this calculation will not be easy. That means that to find out a pipeline schedule would not be an easy task in case of non-linear pipeline. Okay, so how to generate a pipeline schedule in case of non-linear pipeline, that we will be looking at in this lecture. Okay, so just consider the previous example. So I have drawn the same example here, so you have to consider this example, and the arrow shows how the data flows from one stage to another. So this arrow shows the initialization of the first stage, that is S1. S1 output is going to S2 as input, and S2 output is working as an input to S3. Okay, so this arrow shows how the data or how the input from one stage to another stage, how you can give that input or how you can flow the data from one stage to another. Okay, apart from non-linear, it is a multifunction pipeline. Yes, it is a multifunction pipeline, because when you feed input to the S1 stage, so S1 stage is generating an output, you can call it X, and S3 stage is also generating one output, you can call it Y. Okay, so this is a multifunction pipeline. Okay, which means same pipeline, same set of stages S1, S2, S3, which are connected to each other in non-linear fashion, they are producing two outputs, one through S1 directly from S1 and one through S3. Okay, so you can call it addition and multiplication simultaneous. There are two functions there. X represents maybe addition or some other function, Y represents maybe multiplication. Okay, so you can draw an analogy that this is a multifunction non-linear pipeline. S1 is generating one output and S3 is generating another output. Okay, so let's say we are just considering here that there are two outputs, capital X and capital Y. Okay, X require 8 time steps to complete and Y require 6 time steps to complete. So we will see their reservation table in the next slide. Okay, So this is again a multifunction pipeline. You can take analogy of addition and multiplication. So x may be addition or y may be multiplication. Now, as I have already told you, to assume that x require 8 clock cycles to complete or 8 time steps to complete, and y require 6 time steps or 6 clock cycles to complete. So in the right side, I have drawn a reservation table for x. In the left side, I have drawn the reservation table for y. So this diagram is also known as stage time sequence, okay, or sequence of stage occupancy. Okay, so here input data goes to S1, yes, so it starts from S1, then it goes to S2 in the second time step, then it goes to S3 in the third time step. In the fourth time step, S3 output is going to S2 as input, S2 output is going to S3 as input in the fifth time step, and this is how this operation goes on. Same here, it starts from S1, it goes to S3 in the second time step, it goes to S2 in the third time step, then S2 output is going to S3 as input in the fourth time step, and so on. Okay, so I have drawn again that pipeline. So this is your x input and this is your y input. X is coming directly from S1 and S3 outputs y. So these are two outputs, multifunction output. Now, how you should schedule this pipeline so that collision must not happen? Okay, so we have to look at latency so that the collision should not occur. So latency means the number of time units of clock cycles between two successive stages of a pipeline. Okay, so let's say, please see this reservation table. So this is one. At one time step, S1 is utilizing the input, okay, and at the sixth time step, again S1 is getting the chance of dealing with input. Okay, so this is the latency, that number of time units of clock cycles between two successive initiation of a pipeline is called latency between them. Okay, so it would be more clear to you when we see the example. Now, any attempt by two or more initiation to use the same pipeline stage at the same time will cause a collision. Okay, so if we are trying to initialize the input at the same stage at the same time, it will cause a collision. Okay, so please see the example here. Now, we should be careful enough when we are scheduling a collision free pipeline. So that is why I have given you an idea of latency. So latency is initiation of input between two successive initiation corresponding to the same stage. So here, at time step 1, S1 has dealing with input, and at time step 6, again S1 has the S1 is getting the input from S3. Okay, so what is the forbidden latency here? 6 minus 1, so 5 is a forbidden latency. So what is forbidden latency? Distance between two cross or two check marks for same row or for same stage. So the latency that can cause collision are called forbidden latencies. Okay, we cannot use those latencies. So please read it again, or please note it very carefully in your mind, that the latencies that can cause collisions are called forbidden latencies. We must not use those latencies, because if we use those latencies, it will cause a collision. Okay, and what is your forbidden latency? How to compute what is your forbidden latency corresponding to a particular stage? You just subtract the two time steps, or you find out the distance between two time steps, between the two check marks in the same row of the respective reservation table. So here, this is a stage S1. So at first time step, there is a check mark. At sixth time step, there is a check mark. So your forbidden latency would be 6 minus 1, that is 5. Your forbidden latency would be 8 minus 1, that is 7. Okay, so So these are all forbidden latencies. So for S2, 4 minus 2 is 2. Okay. For S3, 5 minus 3 is 2. Okay. 7 minus 3 is 4. Okay. Again, 7 minus 5 is 2. Okay. Now 8 minus 6 is 2. 6 minus 1 is 5. 8 minus 1 is 7. So that is how you can evaluate the forbidden latencies. Forbidden latencies are those latencies where collision may occur. So we should not use those forbidden latencies in our further computations. I hope it is clear to you. So I have noted down the forbidden latencies here. Forbidden latencies are 2, 4, 5 and 7. Okay. And this is for X. Now for Y, I have already told you to assume that there are 6 time steps or 6 clock cycles needed for Y. Okay. So here what are the forbidden latencies? So this 5 minus 1 is 4. Okay. And this 4 minus 2 is 2. 6 minus 4 is also 2. And 6 minus 2 is also 4. So 2 and 4 are the forbidden latencies. And here there is only one check mark or one mark, so that it is a constant latencies. It is not a forbidden latencies. It is a constant latency which is equal to 3. Now you can define another very important term, that is latency sequence. So latency sequence is defined as a sequence of permissible non-forbidden latencies between successive task initiations. So let's say you have found a latency sequence which is comprising non-forbidden latencies. That means you have eliminated the forbidden latencies so that collision should not occur. Okay. So latency sequence means set of allowed non-forbidden latencies between successive task initiations or between successive check marks in a particular stage. So let's say this 1-to-1 is, for example, 1-to-1 is your latency sequence. So that means between first and second input I am giving a gap of 1. Okay, so this 1 means there is a gap between first and second input. This 2 means there is a gap between second and third of 2 units. Again, this 1 means there is a gap between third and fourth, and that gap is 1. Okay, so that is your latency sequence which defines the gap or which defines duration of your non-forbidden latencies between successive initiations. Okay, so this 1 corresponds to the gap of 1 between first and second, 2 corresponds to gap of 2 between second and third, 1 again corresponds to gap of 1 between third and fourth. So that is how you can evaluate a latency sequence. Latency sequence is set of allowed latencies or set of sequence of permissible non-forbidden latencies between successive task initiations or between successive check marks in a particular stage. Now the third term is your latency cycle. Now latency cycle is a latency sequence that repeats the same subsequence. So here 1-3 is followed by again 1-3, again 1-3 is followed by 1-3. So 1-3 is here your latency cycle because it is repeating the same subsequence. Okay, so 1-3 here is latency cycle. So I have told you there are three terms. Forbidden latencies. Forbidden means the latencies which are not allowed. Okay, so how you are going to evaluate forbidden latencies? You just subtract this time steps for a particular stage, or you see that where are your check marks. So those time steps must be subtracted from one another to evaluate the forbidden latencies. Opposite is your non-forbidden latencies, then latency sequence, then latency cycle. So these are a few important terms you have to remember, because it would be needed when you solve the numerical problems. Okay. So in this case, let's say this is your function X. I have already told you in the last slide that forbidden latencies were 2, 4, 5 and 7. Okay. For function Y, the forbidden latencies of 2 and 4. Now we see that in case of function x, this is your possible latency cycles. Okay, so 1.8 is there for first stage. So 1.8, 1.8, 1.8, this will repeat. So 1.8, 1.8 is the latency cycle for stage S1 in function x. In stage S1, there is a constant latency, that is 3. So please refer to the diagram corresponding to x, you will be able to understand that these are the constant latencies. Here also 1.5 may be your latency cycle, 3 may be your constant cycle, and 3.5 may be your again another latency cycles. Now how you should schedule a collision free latency sequence? So your main objective is to determine the latencies dynamically, so that we should know in advance that where to feed data or where to feed the input. Okay, this would be required when you think of non-collision schedule. Okay, so scheduling such that no collision should occur. Okay, and for that scheduling we need to give a latency sequence, and that latency sequence would tell us that where to feed the data. Okay, and that for that we have to define a collision vector first. So our first and primary step is to define a collision vector first. Okay, so what is your collision vector? If there are n number of columns in the reservation table, the maximum forbidden latency is n-1. So let's say there is a check mark here at the first time step, and at the nth time step there is another check mark. So your maximum forbidden latency would be n-1. So that I have already discussed with you, that you subtract the both time step corresponding to the check marks in a particular stage. Now the permissible latency would lie in between 1 to n-1. So this is your range, that 1 to n-1, this is your permissible latencies. Now because more than m does not make sense, because let's say we have 5 stages in the pipeline, or you have let's say 7 stages in the pipeline. So if you are giving gap of more than 5, okay, then it is of no use. Okay, because in that case it would result in a linear pipeline. Why? Because you are waiting for all those 5 stages to get complete, or you are waiting for all those 5 clock cycles corresponding to the different check marks, and then you are feeding input. Okay, so if you are giving gap of more than number of stages, okay, then there would be no use. Okay, so your collision vector is a m bit binary vector, that is c1 c2 c3 up to cm, where ci is equal to 1 if latency I causes collision, and ci will be equal to 0 otherwise. Okay, so your collision vector would be a binary vector. Binary vector means it would be made up of 1 and 0 starting from c1 c2 c3 up to cm. So please note that this sequence, c1 would be the extreme right and cm would be the extreme left. So c1 c2 c3 up to cm, this would be a collision vector, and where your forbidden latencies would be there, those bits would be made 1, otherwise it would be made 0. So ci is equal to 1 means it will cause collision, and ci is equal to 0 means it will not cause the collision. Okay, and there is one important point, is cm is always 1. Okay, because m is the maximum forbidden latencies. Now I have already told you that 2, 4, 5, 7 are the forbidden latencies for function x, 2 and 4 are the forbidden latencies for function y. Okay, so you can refer that diagram, or while reading this PDF you can make those x and y reservation table in a separate page, and then you see the PDF, so it would be more clear to you. Okay, now I have already told you that 2, 4, 5, 7 are your forbidden latencies for function x, 2 and 4 are your forbidden latencies for function y. So I have made those bits equal to 1. So c2 I have made 1, so this is your c1, this is your c2, so c2 I have made 1, then 4, so 1 2 3 4, c4 I have made 1, c5 I have made 1, and c7 I have made 1. So it's a 7 bit vector which denotes the forbidden latencies equal to 1. So that is your collision vector for function x. Now similarly, function y would be 1010 because forbidden latencies are 2, 4. So 2th bit would be made 1, and 4th bit or your most significant bit would be made 1. So this is your 1010. Now we are going to find out a collision free schedule for function x and function y. Okay, so how we can find that schedule? That for that, please look here. From the collision vector, we can construct a state diagram specifying the permissible state transitions. Okay, so from these collision vector, we have to make a state diagram. Okay, and that state diagram will give us the permissible transition or permissible latency sequence. Okay, so initial state would be the collision vector, and next stage would be at time t plus p. And how you are going to find out the next stage? You shift that present stage by p bits to right, and you make a OR operation, logical OR operation with the initial collision vector c. Okay, so please remember there are only two steps. Okay, from the before that, you must note that from collision vector you have to find out a latency sequence, and that latency sequence will contain the permissible latencies or permissible non-formidable latencies or permissible transitions, state transitions. Okay, and what are those two steps? Your initial state would be the collision vector. Okay, and your next state would be at time t plus p. And how you are going to find out the next state? You just shift the initial vector or collision vector by p bits to the right, and then you find out the logical OR. Okay, so that is how you will evaluate the next stage. So this is your collision vector. Okay, let's say this is your collision vector. This is an example. I am not taking the previous example of function x 2 4 5 7 and function y 2 and 4. So this is just an example I am taking. So in this example, 0 0 1 0 0 0 1 0 1 forbidden latencies are 3 7 9. Okay, now what you do? The forbidden latencies are 3 7 and 9, so you can find out the t plus 2. So t plus 2 means forbidden latency is 3. So you just shift, you can shift it by 1, you can shift it by 2, you can shift it by 4, you can shift it by 5, by 6, by 8, or by more than 9. Okay, so you just have to avoid the forbidden latencies, because on these forbidden latencies you cannot feed the input or you cannot feed the data. Okay, so this is your let's say this is your collision vector. So 1 0 0 0 1 0 1. Okay, so 1 5 7. Okay, so you have shifted this by 2 unit left. So when you shift it by 2 unit left, it would be 1 comes here, 0 0 0. So these two bits would be gone, these two bits would be vanished or discarded when you shift this by 2. And you can append two bits, two zeros here, and then you take the logical OR. Okay, so this is your 1 0 1 0 0 1 1 0 0, the same collision vector I have written here, and this you have shifted two bits because you cannot shift 3 7 9. So you can shift 1 2 4 5 6 and 8. So you have shifted this collision vector by 2 bits. Okay, and you have put here 2 zeros so that you can perform logical OR. So when you perform logical OR, it is giving us 1 3 5 7 9. Okay, so where there is 1 in initial vector, those bits would always be forbidden. So 3 7 9 would always be forbidden, and what vector we have found out after logical OR, those would also be forbidden. Okay, so please see the example. So again, this is your function x. 2 4 5 7 are your forbidden latencies. So I have told you that your initial stage would be collision vector, so this is your collision vector. Now apart from 2 4 5 7, you can shift 1, you can shift 3, you can shift 6, and you can shift more than 7. okay, and then you can take the logical OR to get the latency sequence. So let's say I'm shifting with 1. So how I'm shifting with 1? This is your initial collision vector. I have shifted it by 1 bit. So this 1 will come here, 0 come here, 1 will come here, 1 will come here, 0 will come here, 1 will come here, and this place would be empty. So we will place 1 0 here. We will place a 0 here, then we will take a logical OR. So 0 1 1, 1 0 would be 1, 0 1 again 1, 1 and 1 would be 1, 1 0 would be 1. So here it would be all 1s when we shift it right by 1 unit. Now if we shift it by 3, because you can shift it 3, 3 is not a forbidden latency, it is a non-forbidden latency. So let's say we shift by 3. So if we are shifting it by 3, so this is 101 1010, so the same vector we have written here. Now I am shifting it by 3 bits. Okay, so these two 11 will come here, this 10 will come here, and these 3 bits would empty. So I am placing here 3 zeros, and then we are taking the logical OR. So 01 would be 1, 11 would be 1, 00 would be 0, 11 would be 1, 10 would be 1, 00 would be 1, and 10 would be 1. So this is how you can find out the latency sequence. Okay, so whatever time you have to advance, those many number of bits you have to shift right, and then you have to take the logical OR. So in this way you can evaluate the latency sequence. Okay, so let's say this is your 2 4 5 7. Now you are going to shift it by, you can shift this by 1, you can shift it by 3, you can shift it by 6, or you can shift it by 7 plus, that is more than 7. So you can shift it by 8, or you can shift it by 9. So that you can do. Now please remember that if you are shifting it by more than 7, or if you are shifting it by 8 bits, the same collision vector you will get, because here it would be all zeros. So let's say this is our collision vector. So initial vector would be collision vector, then now we are shifting it one bit right, we are shifting it 3 bit right, we are shifting it 6 bit right, and then we are shifting it 7 plus or more than 7. So you can shift it by 8 bits or 9 bits or more. Okay, so if you are going to shift it by 8 or more, all bits will be odd with all zeros, hence it will be an arrow back, or it would, you are going to get initial vector or collision vector again if you shift it by more than 7 bits or more than number of bits present in the collision vector. So if you make it shift by 8 bits, you are going to same find out the same collision vector. So 8 would form a cycle here. Okay, now if you put shifted by 1, so you are going to get this. If you are going to, again if you shifted by 8 plus, so you are going to get this collision vector again. Now let's say you are going to shift it by 3. So if you shift it by 3, you will get 10 11 011. Now if you again shift this vector by 3, you are going to get it again. If you again shift it by 6 units, it will, you are going to get this vector again. So 3 and 6 are your non-forbidden latencies. So if you shift it by 3 units, you are going to get this vector. If you shift it by 6 units right, then take the OR, you are going to get this vector. And if you again shift this vector by 3 or 6, you are going to get this vector again. Okay, so what meaningful information we are getting here? This 3 and 6 are getting self loop. So plus 3 and plus 6 are resulting in a self loop, which means that we have to remain in the same step. Okay, so if we are going to get the self loop, okay, in this state, that means we should not go beyond this stage. Okay, now please see the other example. So this was 2 and 4. Okay, so 2 and 4 bits would be made 1, other bits would be 0. Now you can shift it by non-forbidden latencies. So you can shift it by 1, or you can shift it by 3, or you can shift it by more than 4, that is 5. Okay, so if you are shifting it by 5, it is creating a self loop. If you shift it by 1 and then you shift it by more than 5 or more than 4, it is getting the same collision vector. If you shift it by 3, you are going to get 3, and then it is making the self loop. If you are shifting it by 5 plus, that means 5 or more, you are going to get this. So 3, 5, so 3, okay, 5, this is self loop, so this is 5, this is 3, so this is self loop, so 3, 5 and 1, 5, 1, 5 means this 1 here and this 5 here. So these 3 are your latency cycles. So what are your latency cycles? 3 is forms a latency cycle plus 5 forms a latency cycle, and 1, 5 in bracket again it is causing a cycle. So from the state diagrams we can determine the latency cycles, and that latency cycles would give us the minimum average latency. So minimum average latency here would be, okay, so here it would be 3, 5, 1, 5. So minimum average latency here would be 3. Why 3? Because you are getting 1, 5, so 1 plus 5 is 3, divided by 2 is 3. Okay, so if there is a simple cycle, state appears only once, and some of the simple cycles are greedy cycles. So greedy cycles means we are getting the minimum latencies out of those cycles. Okay, so from the state diagram we can determine latency cycles that results in minimum average latency. Okay, so in a, if there is a simple cycle, the state will appear only once, and if there is not a simple cycle, there is a greedy cycle, and so from greedy cycles also there may be, we can find out minimum latencies. Okay, so in example 1, from initial node plus 1 would be greedy, and if at plus 3 node, then plus 3 would be greedy. So please see this example. Okay, so plus 1 would be greedy, okay, and plus 3 would be greedy. Okay, so in example 1, from initial node plus 1 would be greedy, and if at you are at node 3, then plus 3 would be greedy. In above example, that means in function y, this example, this 3 is a simple cycle. Okay, and so from initial plus 1 and plus 5 will be greedy, and if you are at this point, if you are at this point, greedy would be plus 3. Okay, and if you are at this point, greedy would be plus 1 and 5. Okay, so that is how you can find out the greedy cycles and simple cycles. So for function x, greedy would be 3, 1, 8. Okay, and simple cycles are 3, 6, 8, 1, 8, 3, 8, 6, 8. So you can find out all greedy and simple cycles. For function y, your simple cycles would be 3, 5, 1, 5 and 3, 5. Greedy would be 3 and 1, 5. So minimum average latency would be 3 for both x and y. Why? If you take out the minimum from here, it would be 3. If you take out again minimum from here, it would be 3. Okay, again, if you are, if you see here, greedy would be 3 here. If you see here, in case of simple cycles, greedy would be 3. So minimum average latency would be 3 for both x and y. Okay, so scheduling algorithm says that if I want to build a control circuit, then that control circuit should be in such a way form that it should be safe to feed data in each of the stage. So your first step would be load collision vector in a shift register R. If least significant bit of R is 1, then do not initiate operation, and if least significant bit of R is not 1, then shift R by right 1 position with 0 insertion. Okay, and then you find out OR. So that is how, this is the algorithm. So this algorithm is just the operation we have carried out before. So what we do, our initial vector would be collision vector, and then we perform shift by non-forbidden latencies, and then we take the OR with collision vector or initial vector. Please remember it. We have to take the OR with initial vector or collision vector only. Now, how do we optimize a pipeline schedule? So again, this is the previous example I have taken. Okay, so here, let's say this is your reservation table. So here, cross mark is here, cross mark is here, forbidden latencies are 4. In S2, cross mark is here, forbidden latencies is 2. In S3, there are cross mark for these two successive stages. So forbidden latencies are 1. Okay, so 1, 2 and 4. So 1, 2 and 4, these bits would be made 1. And apart from these 3 bits, the bits that is third bit, it would be made 0. Okay, so can we insert a delay element here? Okay, so please see here, there are 2 cross mark between the successive stages. Okay, it will always create a collision. Okay, because if you feed input here and after that if you feed input here again, so one input is there, that means execution corresponding to first input is going on here and execution corresponding to another input is going here. Okay, so from here or here, these two stages are using the one type of input and this stage is using another type of input, so it will create a collision or it will create a conflict. So better alternative is you should create a delay element in this pipeline or in this stage sequence. You should insert a delay element or you should insert dummy stages in the original pipeline and then only it will become collision free. Okay, time may increase, that means number of time steps may increase, but it will become collision free. Okay, this will modify the reservation table resulting in a new collision vector. So what we have done, please see this diagram and please see this reservation table. Now we have modified this diagram in this way. So we have created a or inserted a dummy element here. From S3 we are coming back to S1, so in between that we have inserted a dummy element. From S3 again we have inserted a dummy element here. Okay, so that is how we can create a dummy element so that it will result in a new collision vector that would be collision free. Maybe you may have your time may increase, so here number of time steps are 5, here number of time steps become 7, but it ensures the collision free sequence. Okay, so there is a cross mark here, it will move to here, this cross mark will move to here. Okay, so it will not result in a collision. So you can fill fill this state sequence diagram, because I have already given you an idea of forbidden latencies, non-forbidden latencies and how to make a state transition. So let's say this is your collision vector. Okay, so you can have a shift by 1 or 3 or 4, 5 or more than 6, that is 7. So here 4 or 7 plus, that means 4, 8, 9, these are creating the cycles. So this is your self loop, because if you shift it by 4 bit, you are going to get get this sequence. If you shift it by 8 bit, you are going to again get this sequence. Then 1, 7 is a cycle, 5, 4 is a cycle, 5, 8 is a cycle. And if you are at this state and you are shifting it by 5, you are getting the same state again. Okay, so that is how you can create this diagram. Now here minimum average latency would be 2. How to? Because for the greedy cycle 1 and 3. So this is your 3 and this is your 1. So this is a cycle. So 3 plus 1 divided by 2. So it would be 2. So minimum average latency is here 2. Okay. Now, if you insert the dummy stages, or if you insert the dummy, stages in the pipeline, your performance of non-linear pipeline can be improved because it will not result into collision. However, you may get your operation executed by more number of time steps. So please see this example for the following reservation table. Okay, so how or which type of questions you should be asked in exam? For that, please see the following reservation table. So this is your reservation table is given. What are your forbidden latencies? Second is show the state transition diagram. List all simple cycles and greedy cycles. Determine the optimal constant latency cycle and minimum average latency. Last part is determine pipeline throughput for tau is equal to 20 nanoseconds. Okay. So this discussion, that is logic, setup time and skew jitter, that all we have discussed in the previous lecture. So this is your reservation table which is given to you. Now you can find out the collision vector. So this is 1 is your forbidden latency, 4 is your again check mark. Okay, so you can find out 4 minus 1, it would be 3. Here it is single cross mark, so it represents a constant latency. Here again it's a single check mark in this whole stage S3 sequence, so it will again represent a constant sequence, so you don't have to consider this S2 and S3. 4 minus 1 is 3. Okay, so third bit would be made 1 and all other bits corresponding to different stages would be made 0. So this is your one bit, first bit 0, second bit 0 and third bit should be 1. Because 4 minus 1 is 3, so 3 is your forbidden latency, so MSB would be made 1, or third bit would be made 1, otherwise other than 3 the two bits are made 0. So 100. Now you can shift it by 1, you can shift it by 2, or you can shift it by more than 3, that is 4, or more than 3 means 4, 5, 6, or any number more than 3. So if you are shifting it by 1, you are getting this. If you are again shifting it by 1, you are getting this. And if you are shifting this vector by 4 plus means 4 or more, you are again going to getting this. Okay. Now if you are shifting it by more than 4 bits, 4 or more bits, you will get the collision vector again. Okay. You can shift it by 2 bits, you will get this. It will again generate a self loop. If you are shifting it by 4 or more, you are going to get it again. So minimum average latency is here too, because this is creating a self loop. Okay. So to find out minimum average latency, this is a thumb rule. If you are getting a self loop at any state in the state transition diagram, you just say that this is your minimum average latency. Okay. So this is just rough work. So if you are shifting it 1 bit, 100, so it would be this 0 would come here, this 1 would come here, and here you have to put 10. Okay, and then you take the OR. So this is your 110. Now again you have to shift this by 1 bit, because here it's a 0, so you have to shift it by 1 bit. So 011, again you have to take OR with the initial vector, not this 110. You have to take the OR with initial vector, that is 100. It will come 111. So this is your 111. Okay. Now I have told you what are your forbidden latencies. So forbidden latencies are 3. Okay. This is your collision vector. This is your state transition diagram. That is your part B. Okay. List all simple cycles and greedy cycles. Okay. So 4, 2, 4. 2, okay, 114, 4, okay, so these are your simples and greedy cycles. Okay, and greedy cycles would be 2 here, okay, 4 here. Now last part is determine pipeline throughput for tau is equal to 20 nanoseconds. Okay, so this you can solve by looking at the mathematical expression in the last lecture. Now this is the assignment. I am just giving one question in your assignment 3. Okay, so submit it as assignment 3. this reservation table is given to you and you have to find out the answer for these all five parts. What are your forbidden latencies? Show the state transition diagram, all simple cycles and greedy cycles, optimal constant latency cycle and minimum average latency, pipeline throughput for 20 nanoseconds. Now this is example 2 and we will see this example and then we will end our lecture. So this is a non-linear non-pipelined processor X. Okay, so with processor X we do not have execution in a overlapped fashion, there would be no pipelined execution, and it has the clock frequency is 250 megahertz, average CPI of 4. Another processor which is an improved version of X and that supports pipelining, it designed with a 5-stage pipeline. However, due to latch delay and clock skew, the clock rate of Y is only 200 megahertz. Okay, so you have to find out if 5000 instructions run on both processor, what will be the speed up of processor Y over X. Second part is you have to evaluate the MIPS rating for each of the processor. Okay, so speed up is related to execution time, so we are going to find out the execution time for these 5000 instructions for processor X and Y. So I am representing it by execution time of X. So XT of X would be instruction count multiplied by CPI multiplied by clock cycle time or clock period. Okay, so please remember this mathematical expression. Instruction count is 5000, CPI is given 4, and this is given as 250 megahertz. So clock cycle time would be 1 divided by frequency, so 1 divided by 250 into 10 raised to power 6, so it would be 80 microseconds. Okay, now execution time of Y would be 5000 into 1 because it is taking the only one clock cycles. Okay, due to latch delay and clock skew, the clock rate of Y is only 250 megahertz. Okay, so this is your one clock per instruction. Okay, because in each of the stage will take one clock cycle for each of the time steps for any stage, so it would be 1 multiplied by 1 divided by 200 into 10 raised to power 6. This I have written M, so this is mega, that means to 10 raised to power 6. It is coming only 25 microseconds, so speed up would be 80 divided by 25. This micro would cancelled out, so we are getting the speed up of 3.2. now we have to find out MIPS rating, that means millions of instructions per second. Okay, so for 5000 instructions it is taking 80 microseconds. Okay, so your MIPS rating would be in 1 second. Okay, that means just multiply it by, this is your micro, so in 1 second how many millions of instruction would get executed. So 5000 multiplied by 10 raised to power 6 divided by 80, so this is your MIPS rating for processor X. Similarly for Y it would be 5000 multiplied by X divided by 25. Okay, so MIPS rating for processor Y is 200, MIPS rating for processor X is 62.5. you can see that this MIPS rating for processor Y, that is pipelined processor, it's significantly much higher than the non-pipelined processor. Okay, so these sort of numerical you may see in your exam. Okay, so in pipelining you may be asked related to skew, jitter, logic time, setup time, MIPS rating of processor, and to find out a speed up. What are your forbidden latencies, non-forbidden latencies, latency cycles, minimum average latencies, collision vector, state transition diagram. Okay, so please go through this pipelining, first lecture, second lecture, and after that there is one more lecture which is related to your arithmetic pipeline, that means how you can perform arithmetic operations, that is addition, subtraction, multiplication and division with respect to linear and non-linear pipeline. Okay, so we will end our lecture here, and before that I am going to tell you that in the next lecture I would be discussing arithmetic pipeline, that means pipeline for different operations, addition, subtraction, multiplication or division. And you have to go through this lecture and the previous lecture, that is basic pipelining concept and this pipeline scheduling, because this pipelining part is typical. Okay, so if you not go through in detail, it would not fruitful for you to prepare for exam. Okay, so please go through these two lectures and the lecture which is the third lecture of pipeline that I'm going to cover in the next, that is arithmetic pipeline. Okay, so thank you. We end our lecture here and we'll meet tomorrow.